which are acting in the body itself of society. What I see is a kind of embedding of automatic relationships between an act, another act, another act. Any possibility of distancing, understanding, deciding is over. If you look at the last summit in Bruxelles, just 1 week ago, the Save Everything summit, everybody was there saying, oh, Angela Merkel and Sarkozy are going to meet, so maybe they will find some solution for our situation. Well, what did they decide? Frankly, it's difficult to understand, but I did. I read carefully and I understood. They decided that the principle, the theoretical dogma of, how do you say in English, the balance, the parità di bilancio, the balance of the budget balance, has to become a constitutional principle in every European country. Well, you know, in order to introduce this concept, this rule, this law, in the constitutions, we have to wait 6 months, 1 year, maybe 2 years. But this is not the problem, because that principle is a criminal principle. It's the idea that the balance, the financial balance of the state is the number one. Society is the number I don't know what. So that is the problem, that the idea of a financial rectification of language has become the general framework of European politics. That means two things. One, they don't know what to do. This is crystal clear. Second, what they decide is very dangerous, methodologically speaking. It's only methodology, don't worry. But it's very dangerous at the methodological level. So this is why I say the trap is already there. The trap has already been built and is already working. The trap is already sucking dry society. The trap is already destroying, first of all, the school. The process of descolarization is in full swing in Europe, and you know what descolarization means for the next 5-10 years. Barbarianism, fascism, racism, destruction. I think that we should try to not to come out from the trap, which means little. I think that we should start thinking in terms of insolvency. Insolvency is a magic word that is circulating somewhere in Italy, in Spain, in Europe. What is the meaning of insolvency? At a basic level, insolvency means I don't pay. It's that easy. But we are not talking insolvency as a national task. We don't care about the national debt of Italy, of France, and so on. That is not the problem. We are talking insolvency by the point of view of society. I mean, we are trying to circulate the idea that the debt relationship has to be cancelled. We have no debt. But we have no debt at a very daily level. For instance, in Bologna, a group of people have created, you know, in Italy we like very much to have a saint, so they have created Santa Insolvenza, Saint Insolvency. And Saint Insolvency is producing tickets for the bus, tickets for the train. Now, in the Christmas period, they are producing tickets of 21% less. That means that they go to the supermarkets and give people tickets saying, with this ticket, you have the right to ask for a reduction of the prices. What will happen, I don't know. But you see, well, this is a starting point. We are trying to circulate the idea that paying is not mandatory. Paying is not healthy. And also, we are starting the idea that we have to print money. So I come to the last part of my what? I want to say something about printing money, and also want to say something about money and language. Because if we start to sitting by the point of view of language and not by the difficult point of view of money, probably we make some steps forward. Money and language have very much in common. They are nothing, and they move everything. Okay, that is the character, the specificity of those two tools. Can I say that language is a tool? I cannot say. Language is not a tool. Language is an environment, and it's an environment. And it's the environment where I can move things, people, feelings, sentiments, hopes, with words. The same happens with money. Money is doing exactly the same. It's nothing, but it's able to move things, people, sentiments, hopes, expectations. So, first of all, let's start thinking that as money is nothing, as money is a simulation, why not producing money ourselves? Not far from here, in the small city of Ithaca, they have done that for many years. I was there 1 year ago, and someone told me, you can pay with Ithaca hours, you can get a coffin somewhere. I like the idea of the Ithaca hours, but I think that in Italy we are thinking something more complicated, but probably more useful. We are trying to think that every community has the right to print money. And when you print money, you use the money, first of all, inside the community. Then you try to push your money also outside the community. I go to the barber shop, I go to the kiosk, I go to the, I don't know, the bike seller, and I say, I want your bike. It's $100. Okay, I give you $80 of the Federal Reserve, $20 of my community. Do you agree? If you don't agree, I go to another bike. Okay? And what can I do with your 20 community money? You can go to the greengrocer, my friend greengrocer, and he will give you 80% of dollars lettuce and apples, and 20% you can pay with community money. My sister is a psychoanalyst, and she has decided that 20% of the money the patients have to give her will be community money. So you start circulating 20%, then 25%, then 30%. As the community grows, the percentage, the part of money that can be fake money, true money, our money, will grow. Well, this is another idea. We have to think about 100 possibilities of printing money. Printing money, of course, means also printing money in the true sense of the word. I am unable to do that, but someone, it seems that the euro has been created with the special aim of being unfalsifiable. Who knows? Anyway, that is one of the many possibilities we have to look for. But I want to say something more about the relationship between money and language. And I want to focus on language at the very end, because language is crucial by many points of view in the present economic and financial collapse, especially because the economy has become a linguistic economy. It's an economy where the linguistic products and the linguistic production process is more and more important, is more and more central, and at the end this has produced an effect not only on the economy but also on language. Language has become a kind of automatism, and if you listen to the political language, it's so clear that language has become totally fake, totally automatic. And so I think that a crucial task of the next phase, the next period, is to de-automatize language. The automatizing language, I think, to what Viktor Shklovsky, the Russian formalist, said. He says, we use the word stone so many times that when we say stone, we don't see nothing. The word has lost his magic, his ability to create, to produce, to evocate, to make things emerge. But poetry, says Shklovsky, poetry is there exactly because the aim of poetry, of ostranemia in the Shklovsky language, the ability to see things in a strange way, in an unpredictable way, this is giving new life to words. I change my subject again. I want to go outside from language and money, and I want to go to the body. It's the body, the problem of this collapse. Not language, not money, the body. It's the body which has been reduced to a linguistic tool by the linguistic machine. We are witnessing to the emergence of a new generation that has learned more words from a machine than from the mother. This generation has some problems with empathy, has some problem with touching, has some problem with feeling the pleasure of the presence of body. Here lies the problem. The problem is solidarity. The problem is the understanding that solidarity is not a moral value. It's not a political value. Solidarity is the pleasure of the body of the other. This is solidarity. This is why the problem of body is absolutely crucial in the present crisis. If you are able to feel, not to think, to feel that the presence of the body of the other is the condition of your pleasure, is the condition of your social strength. If you're able to understand that, then language and money are easy to change, falsify, to reinvent. Well, I think that the methodology for going beyond the Nazist trap is poetry. Poetry is not only the creation, the invention of a new path, of a new possibility of space. Poetry is also the condition of a reconstitution of social solidarity. And social solidarity means we are strong, fascism is nothing. Thank you.